Thank you so much. So hi, my name is Lior, and I'm a senior cloud security architect for a company called Ermetic. Now, in case you haven't heard of Ermetic, Ermetic is a comprehensive cloud security solution. So what this means is that we provide security in multi-layers relevant to cybersecurity in the cloud. Now, just to give you a little bit of orientation, what we're going to talk about today is a new feature that we recently released called just-in-time access. So the talk is here, right? We do a lot of layers. One of them is identity. And one of the abilities that we provide for identities is the just-in-time access that we're going to talk about today. So the first thing that we want to do is we want to understand why this feature is important. And in order to get to that, we first need to understand that there's a significant difference between service identities, that is, identities that are used by workloads, and human identities, that is, identities that are used by people. Now, when it comes to service identities, right, they're consistent, usually. They're predictable, right? Hopefully, we know what the code that they're running is supposed to be doing, what it's supposed to reach, and that's how we can somewhat right-size or even significantly right-size the permissions that they get, right? Now, this is, of course, not an easy thing to do unless you're using Ermetic, but it's within reach. So when it comes to people, by definition almost, they're very less predictable, right? It's hard for us to know what it is exactly that they're supposed to do, and that's the reason why we have people on our payroll, right? Because if we could predict what they're going to do, we would automate this and then let go of the people. Now, this creates a situation where we need to provide them with broad access, right? It's very hard for us to right-size them, to right-size their permissions significantly. And also, when they find new things that they need to do, they ask for more permissions. We give it to them, and unfortunately, these permissions just stay on. So this creates a situation where people have very, very broad access. And sometimes this access is for very, very, very sensitive resources. Now, this, in combination with the fact that people are also very, very vulnerable, can create a very, very bad situation, right? I mean, if, for example, you provide the people with access keys for some reason, which you probably shouldn't do, but if you do, then they sometimes post them on Slack, or they put them in a public S3 bucket, they leak. That's a big problem. And of course, people are prone to social engineering, not to mention that their endpoints can get hacked. So together, this creates a situation where they have sometimes very, very broad access to sensitive resources, and they are, in fact, a sensitive and weak link in your security chain. However, you have to give them these kinds of permissions, right? Because otherwise, they will tell you, look, it's hard for me to do the job, right? So not anymore. This is exactly why we recently released a feature called just-in-time access. So it provides you the ability to give people the access to sensitive resources just when they need it. So these permissions don't exist permanently, which makes them much more and more secure. So what we want to reach with this feature for your environment is something we call zero standing trust. That means that people have minimal or even no permanent permissions to those sensitive resources. Now, a user, if they need, in some situation, access to those sensitive resources, may be eligible to ask for those permissions when they need them. And when they need them, they make requests that needs to be approved. And once they approve, they get the access temporarily for just a specific duration of time, and after which, they're gone, right? So there are no standing permissions all the time for those sensitive resources. So if there's some kind of a breach, the fallout from it is significantly lower. So the way it works is, let's say that we have a user, let's say it's a developer, and it has a development environment. So it has permanent access to a role in that development environment. Now, let's say that there's a production environment, right, which obviously has a lot more sensitivity to it. And there is some kind of production issue, right? And that developer needs access to that production environment, right? Now, if you don't have the ability to give the access just in time, you will permanently give them access, so just in case, right? So they have the access. So if they're on call and they need to do something, they're going to use it. But if you have Ermetic, what you can do is have the developer request for access just when they need it. Ermetic will manage just-in-time permissions in AWS IAM Identity Center, and then they will get approved just-in-time access for that production environment for a specific duration of time. And once that duration is over, they're gone, right? So there are no permanent access to the sensitive production environment. So the way the flow would work is there's the requester. They, of course, sign in and SSOs into your AWS environment via their identity provider. And there is Ermetic on the side. Now, when the requester need the access to the production environment, they request it via Ermetic. The approver gets notified of it. They approve it, of course, if the request makes sense. And then Ermetic takes care of everything in front of AWS. Now, another cool thing in this architecture is that Ermetic can interface with third parties in order to make this flow seamless within the working environment of the developer. So we can integrate with stuff like Slack or PagerDuty or emails, and we will see how that happens. So requests can go from these other third parties that developers and security professionals are already using, and they can also get notifications via them. Right, so this is the overall architecture. Now, without further ado, let's see how this looks in the Ermetic console. So in Ermetic, you have the ability to provide eligibilities. Eligibilities are not actual permissions. They're just the ability to request for permission. So the way it works is I add an eligibility to a user, to AWS accounts, to specific roles. And then I can determine that when they ask for this specific permission, the maximum duration that they can get is within hours, right? Or in this case, it's 6 hours. Now, I can also define that their request require explicit approval and who is the approving user, right? So the way this would work is, let's say I have a developer. This is what he sees normally, right? When he logs in via the identity provider to AWS, they see access to their development account, right? They don't have permanent access to the production account. But let's say they're on call, and there's a problem with the production environment that for some reason only they can solve, and they need access to that production environment. So what they would do is they would go to the Ermetic console. They would request access because they have an eligibility to do that. They would choose the production account. They would choose the role that they want. They would ask for a specific amount of time, in this case, 1 hour, and they would specify the reason why they need it. Now, the approver is notified of that. They see the request. They decide whether to approve it or not. And once they approve it, the developer now has access to both environments. And of course, when the time goes by, the permission to access the production environment goes away. Now, another very cool thing about this feature is because the access is just granted for a specific duration, Ermetic is able to show you everything that happened during this session. So when you audit, you don't just audit the eligibilities or the request that happened, but for each request, you can go and view user activity. And you get a log in a very, very approachable and readable format that allows you to see all the CloudTrail events that happened during that specific session. So when the session is over, you don't just remove the permissions, but you can make sure that the permissions that were granted during the specific sessions weren't abused. That is a very powerful thing. Now, we mentioned that we can use third-party integrations to make this even seamless, right? Because what we don't want to do, or we prefer not to do, is give another console for people to use, right? So we want people to be able to use the current tools that they have in order to make this process work. So let's demonstrate how an integration with Slack and PagerDuty would look like. So let's say we have a developer in the same situation, the same scenario, and they want to request access. So instead of going to a separate console, what they would do is just do /JIT request. When they do that, they get access to the same dialogue that we saw before. They can choose, again, the environment. They can choose the role. They can specify the duration and the reason. And once they do that, they can submit a request. Right? Now, Slack also enables us to build a nice functional chat. Right? It's not just text that goes. So you can see all the requests that you made in the past. You can even edit them. And once you submit them, then the approver can actually go and see the request and approve them straight from their Slack console. Now, another interesting thing is the ability to integrate with PagerDuty. Right? We mentioned that in the scenario that we talked about, the developer would request the access because they're on call. Right? They don't just want to go into the production environment. They go into the production environment because there's an issue that arose, and they are the ones that's supposed to deal with it. Right? This is the edge case that for which we want to give them specific access for that specific amount of time. Now, what a PagerDuty integration would allow us to do is to show the approver that the person requesting the access is actually on call. Right? So let's say that a person, the developer is phished, right? So they're hacked. Now, in order to make that work, the attacker would not only have to phish them and make a request, they would have to do it when they're on call, or they would have to somehow fool PagerDuty to make them think that they're on call, which makes it another hurdle for them to fool the approver in order to give them those permissions. So to sum up, the benefits of this approach is that if you only give those permissions just when they're actually needed, you limit drastically the impact that security events would have on your infrastructure. But not only security events, by the way, also operational mistakes. Right? If developers or anyone has any kind of redundant permissions, they might use them by mistake and make damage. Now, another thing that it enables session monitoring. As we mentioned before, you can go over exactly what happened and make sure that even the permissions granted temporarily weren't abused during the session. Right? You can do it after each session. And finally, even if something bad happens, or you need to go through an audit, and you need to make sure that access to these sensitive environments wasn't abused in the past, or you need to find out why something bad actually happens, and you want to do this kind of auditing and investigation, you do it in a much more focused way. Right? You don't have to go through months of logs, but you have a list of the specific times when access was actually granted, and then you can go over these specific logs, which are much, much, much more focused. So I want to thank you all for coming. And if you want to see more about what we do, or if you have any kind of questions, first of all, I'm going to stick around. And second of all, you can go by our booth, which is 1020. If you take a right here and you get to the 1000 banner, the aisle 1000 banner, and you take a left, walk right past the bathrooms, look to your right, you should see our booth. So again, thank you all so much for your attention and your time, and I appreciate it. Thank you.